Dear viewers, welcome to our channel GVS Bank Academy. Today I am going to discuss about JAB, legal and regulatory aspect of banking, record questions, part 6. Question number 116, Income Tax Act, Unit number 39. These are the questions which they are asking generally in this. A. Intimation under section 143(1) of Income Tax Act. Intimation under section 143 of Income Tax Act. An SSE would receive intimation under section 143(1) of the section if the SSE has paid either more or less than the amount required which is actually liable to pay. At that time, if he has less paid or more paid, then only he will get a notice, intimation from income tax officer under section 143(1). So, an SSE would receive intimation under section 143(1). This question also they are asking several times. Question number B. Failure to pay tax to the credit of central government. After deduction of TDS from the salaries or from the departments, it shall be deposited to the government account. Failure to pay tax to the credit of the central government, he shall be punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term which shall be between 3 months and 3 months minimum up to 7 years along with fine. So, any official who had deducted the TDS from the employees and from others, and it had to be remitted to the government department. If the person has failed to pay, remit the tax to the central government, he shall be punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term of minimum 3 months, maximum 7 years, and along with fine also. Now, see, 10, tax deduction and collection account number. Tax deduction and collection account number. They are asking about this also. It is a 10-digit alphanumeric number. It is a 10-digit alphanumeric number. The number is required to be quoted on all TDS returns. It is a 10-digit alphanumeric number. This number is quoted on all TDS returns. The TAN number is needed to be obtained by all the persons who are responsible for deducting the TDS and collecting the taxes. So, it is important for TAN number, the persons who are deducting the TDS and collecting these taxes. For them, this is tax deduction and collection account number. This question also, from this unit 39, this question. Contributions, donations made to certain relief funds and charitable institutions can be claimed as deduction under Income Tax Act, Section 80G of the Income Tax Act. So, these four questions generally from this unit number 39, they are asking. These four questions covers at least very, very important, almost repeatedly they are asking in the examinations. Information Technology Act, Unit number 67, this is the last unit in legal and regulatory aspect of banking. In the examination, one question compulsory or two questions also sometimes we are getting. This the act aim is, Information Technology Act aim to provide legal framework for the legal for the electronic. This act be the main object is it is providing legal framework for electronic records. That is the main object. Now B, official gadget published in electronic form is called electronic gadget. This question at least 4 or 5 times they had asked in the exam. Official gadget in electronic form, that is called electronic gadget. C, recognition of electronic signature. I think December 2020 also exam they had asked this question. Recognition of electronic signature. Section 5 of the Information Technology Act 2000. The legal recognition of electronic signature has been provided under Section 5 of the Information Technology Act. Legal recognition to electronic signature. This section equates electronic signature has traditional handwritten signature. So that is the importance. Traditional handwritten signature is equivalent to electronic signature, and electronic signature also equivalent to traditional handwritten signature. This is the legal recognition of electronic section 5. Penalties for damage to computers, computer system has been fixed as damaged by the compensation not exceeding 1 crore to affected person. Any persons damaging the computers, computer system has been fixed as damages by way of compensation not exceeding 1 crore. Appeal to. Now, whenever any case is there, adjudicating authorities, the affected persons can appeal to against adjudicating authority cyber regulations appellate tribunal. So appeal to cyber regulation appellate tribunal against the adjudicating officer's orders. This is called appeal to cyber regulation appellate tribunal. This is the unit, very important unit is information technology. Now, submission of CRR and SLR return to RBA. Cash reserve ratio return is a fortnightly return. Fortnightly return. After completion of the fortnight, the banks have to submit to RBA within 20 days. Completion of the fortnight within 20 days. In Form A, CRR return has to be submitted to RBA within 20 days from the end of the fortnight, CRR balances. SLR return. These are the two statutory returns bank has to submit. Statutory return, statutory liquidity ratio, this is a monthly return. After completion of the month, next month 20th, before 20th of succeeding month, they have to send to RBA. In which form they have to submit? Form 8 SLR statement. SLR is monthly after completion of the month, 20th day, next month. CRR after completion of the fortnight within 20 days in Form A. CRR, SLR in Form 8. These are questions, this question they had asked in December 20 also. Now, 119, doctrine of indoor management. This is companies, regarding companies. Doctrine of indoor management lays down that the outsiders are not required to see the compliance of internal regulations. Any outsider is dealing with the company, they need not see the company internal regulations of the company. It means whenever any person is dealing with the customer company, they need not verify and see whether they are complied the company guidelines, regulations, rules and others. This is not required to the person outsider for verification of the same. This is the meaning. The doctrine of indoor management seeks to protect outsiders against the company. The doctrine of indoor management seeks to protect against outsiders against the company. This is the doctrine of indoor management. Very important doctrine of indoor management. Agreement to sale. This is Sales of Goods Act. Agreement to sale, when the transfer of property in the goods used to take place at future time. So, after sale, agreement to sale means when the transfer of property in the goods is to take place at a future time. Means presently if you are selling, the property is going to be transferred at a future time, not on the date of sale. That is the meaning of that. Or subject to some condition thereafter to be fulfilled. After contract of sale, some condition thereafter to be fulfilled. The contract is called agreement to sell. Agreement to sell. When the transfer of property in the good to take place at a future date or subject to some condition thereafter, this is. Fixed charge and a floating charge. Fixed charge means against fixed assets of the companies, land, building, plant and machinery, etc. And floating charge means against current assets of the company, stock, book debts, other paper securities, stocks, book debts. Because In this case, the charge is the stock movement from raw material to finished, semi-finished goods, finished goods to converting into book debts. Means here the state of the asset is not static. This is going on moving from one point to another point. That's why floating charge against current assets means stock, book debts are the best examples. Fixed charge against fixed assets, that is land, building and plant and machinery. Reverse mortgage, question number 122. Reverse mortgage means it is a loan against residential property for senior citizens. The banks are giving loan to senior citizens against their residential property. That is called reverse mortgage. And during the tenure of this loan, there is no need to repay the loan by the senior citizens. That is second point. For third point is, under whenever the bank is giving a loan to senior citizens, the first borrower age is 60 years and the second borrower age is not less than 55 years. This point also we have to remember. Sometimes they are asking questions. Now, Bankers Book Evidence Act 1891, this is under unit number 33. From this question, unit, one question compulsory in examination, legal and regulatory, one question compulsory. What are that question normally? A certified copy of an entry in the bank's books is received as a prima facie evidence of the existence of such entry in all legal proceeds under the provisions of Bankers Book Evidence Act. So, whatever the certified copy of the entry in the bank's book is received as a prima facie evidence of the existence of the such entry. So, they need not submit the original books entries. Only certified copy certified by the bank officials is enough, and it also has a prima facie evidence for the existence of such entry or transaction. Unless the court otherwise directs, the bank officer cannot be compelled to produce original. So, if court is directing for submission of the originals, then only the bank officer has to submit. Otherwise, there is no need. Question number 124, payment and settlement system is regulated by RBI, Reserve Bank of India. Payment and settlement. This is company's question. Director's tenure. What is the period of the directors in the company? Additional directors appointed by the board of directors. And these additional directors shall continue up to the next AGM general body meeting. Additional directors are continue in the office of the company as a director till next AGM annual general body meeting. Additional directors are appointed by board of directors. Alternative directors. Second point, alternative directors. Board of directors can appoint alternative directors during the original director's absence, when the original director absent for a period of not less than 3 months. So, one of the original director gone abroad for more than 3 months, in his place, the board of directors can appoint a alternative directors in the original director place. What is the tenure of the alternative director? The alternative director had to vacate his office when the original director returns from abroad. The alternative director vacates his office as a director when the original director returns from abroad. So, that's why there is no fixed tenure period there. As long as the absence of the original director, he can continue as a director. That is called alternative directors. Casual vacancy of directors. Casual vacancy means death of the directors, resignation of the directors normally. So, in the case of death or resignation of the directors, board of directors are appointed the directors in the place of the deceased director or the directors resigned. In their place, the board of directors are appointing the directors in a board meeting. In the casual vacancy positions, if the director appointed by the board of directors, they can continue as directors that director can hold continue as director in the office of the company only up to the date up to which the director in whose place he is appointed. So in the place of death of the director or in the place of resignation, whatever the original tenure of the deceased director or resignated director, up to that period only they can continue as a director. This is the suppose one director was resigned after completion of 1 year, for example. One director was resigned after completion of 1 year. Suppose his total tenure is 3 years. So 1 year is over. Remaining 2 years, whatever the director appointed in the place of resignated director, he continue to hold office next 2 years. That is the meaning of casual vacancy of directors. Partnership Act, very, very important. Unit number 49 to 54, legal and regulatory aspect. So total 5 units are there. At least 5 to 10 marks weightage, 5 marks weightage is there in the examination. Some of the points I am discussing. Section 4, definition of partner, definition of partnership firm. Now they are asking in the examination, under which section partner was defined, for section 4. Under which section partnership was defined, section 4. Under which section partnership firm was defined, section 4. B, unregistered partnership firm cannot enforce suit against any third parties. All partners are entitled to share equally in the profits earned. In the profits, here it was loss not mentioned. All partners are entitled to share equally in the profit earned. Nothing is mentioned in the partnership deed. And whenever the partners are eligible for interest on capital, that interest is to be paid only out of profits of the firm. If the firm is earning profits, then only interest is going to be paid to the capital. Loss is there, no interest to the capital, no interest to the partners on the capital. E, interest at 6% on extra amount paid by the partner. So any partner has contributed more than required amount as per partnership deed or more than required as per partner's agreement, then on the extra amount of the capital contributed, he will get 6%. Interest at 6%, that is there. Loan to partnership firm. Loan document should be signed by all the partners. When the bank is giving a loan, who will execute the documents to partnership? Loan document should be signed by all the partners. Same manner, whenever the bank is giving a loan to company's account, the loan documents should be executed by the names mentioned in the board of directors resolution. Company accounts documents are executed as per the resolution passed by the board of directors. This question also, company, one time they are asking company account, another time they are asking partnership account. Now, loans and advances, statutory and other restrictions. A bank cannot grant any loan advances on security of its own shares. So, bank cannot sanction any loan against its own shares. No advance against partly paid up shares. Banks are not going to finance partly paid up shares because part amount is paid, part amount is not paid. That's the way that is. Bank should not extend finance for setting up of new units producing the ozone depleting substances. This is for normal condition. No bank should grant any loan advance for subscription of to Indian depository receipts. No bank should grant any loan advance for subscription to Indian depository receipts. What is meant by Indian depository receipts? Foreign companies are issuing depository receipts in India. That is called Indian depository receipts. If any company is issuing Indian deposit, foreign company is issuing Indian deposit receipts in India, for that subscription, bank cannot sanction any loan. That is the. The bank should desist from sanctioning advances against FDRs of other banks. So, against other bank deposits, banks are not sanctioning loan against other bank deposits. This is the deposits against other banks. No loan to be granted to partnership firm and proprietorship firm concerns against the primary security of shares and debentures. No loan to be granted to partnership firm and proprietorship concern against the primary security of shares and debentures. So, bank can sanction loan against share to only individuals. Banks are not allowed to sanction loan against share to partnership firm and proprietorship firm. So, this is the questions and presentation on today. Thank you very much, viewers, for extending support to our YouTube channel. Please share this news, our YouTube channel news, among your friends. It is going to be benefited for the forthcoming examinations. We are also conducting online classes for JAB and CAB for the forthcoming examinations. Interested members are requested to contact. Thank you very much for all.